Kobane has been pounded again today by American bombers and Islamic State suicide attacks. But its Kurdish defenders feel that the air attacks, whatever their limitations, are having some effect in checking the enemy advance.
Alpha,
the airstrike campaign is very inefficient. The planes aren't really where you'd want them to be. US, French and UAE jets are flying from Al Dhafra Air Base. Other American sorties are coming from Al Udeid in Qatar, as well as carriers in the Red Sea and Gulf. That's a journey of anything between 1,500 and 2,300 kilometres to reach targets. The planes have to be refueled in flight, and the weapons load is cut by the need to carry extra fuel tanks. Up until the end of September, there had been 1,449 tanker missions, approaching the number of strike sorties. Another key problem is the shortage of intelligence, or finding suitable targets that are far enough away from civilians to be hit safely. So of the first 949 strike missions flown by the Americans, fewer than 10%, just 90, actually launched attacks. That's gone on. Most planes flown over the target at such expense and fuel and effort head back again without hitting anything.
When the insurgents don't have air power, certainly in Afghanistan, if they heard the noise of the jets, that sent them scurrying for cover. So actually, just a show of force or the noise brings a threat of violence which they can't match. So in many ways, you're trying to avoid the situation where you're actually delivering bombs, mainly because the rules of engagement mean that however precise that we can be with our bombs, it's very difficult to make sure that you're absolutely guaranteed there are no civilian casualties.
The strikes so far have been heavily weighted to Iraq rather than Syria, and there are telltale clues that many have supported the Iraqi Kurds near Erbil and Kirkuk and other places where US special forces are thought to be directing strikes on the ground, like Sinjar and the Mosul Dam. In Anbar and north of Baghdad, where there are not believed to be American spotters, there are far fewer strikes, despite the militants' push. The IS offensive in Anbar targets remaining garrisons and bastions of Sunni tribes that are still loyal to the Iraqi government.
The Islamic State needs the Sunni Arab tribes because they will obviously be completely rejected in, let's say, Shia Arab Iraq or Alawi Syria, along with Kurdistan. And so they need some base of local support in these areas, which they've had, again, due to the misrule out of Baghdad and Damascus. But now what we're beginning to see is, as we saw with Al-Qaeda in Iraq in 2005 and 2006, we're beginning to see that the Sunni Arab tribes have already had enough of the Islamic State and are beginning to turn on them and cooperate with both Western governments and with even the government in Baghdad.
This is the strategic contest of the moment. And that's why in the past few days, the Americans have started to fly Apache helicopters in support of the Iraqis here. Based in Baghdad, they can get on target quickly, but with a bigger risk of getting shot down.
When you talk about attack helicopters like the Apache, they bring a very, very interesting dimension to this. And undoubtedly, they have some really powerful tactical benefits. But you also start putting a footprint on the ground. Also, you start operating platforms in an area where they are more vulnerable to small arms fire.
Meanwhile, the Iraqi army is also finding itself under serious pressure around Balad, north of Baghdad. And the Islamic State is also on the offensive across the border in Syria. There, they've been crushing the Kobane pocket, as well as striking in the Hasakah region and the Rif Aleppo. In Syria, there's no coalition forces on the ground to direct strikes, and the real opposition to IS is, of course, President Assad's army.
You can try to degrade the capabilities of Al-Qaeda or the Islamic State with airstrikes, but you can frankly do minimal damage to them because very quickly they'll retreat into populated civilian areas. And so that's why we need much more capabilities on the ground. I'm not talking about boots on the ground necessarily, but I'm talking about much more advanced intelligence resources being dedicated to the cause in both Iraq and in Syria.
How to have a greater effect? Well, basing more aircraft in Iraq and Turkey would be one thing, but increasing the flow of intelligence for their strikes is critical, and that will mean more people on the ground. But plans to do that in Syria, with more Free Syrian Army and special forces from Arab countries, could still take months to mature. Meanwhile, Turkey continues to consider taking a buffer zone in Syria and Iraq, another step with big potential consequences. Overall, then, the coalition attacks so far have had some effect, but raised expectations that could hardly be met and seem bound to drag foreign forces deeper into the battle.